start a panel discussion now on the evolutionary origins of self. You know, Stuart Kauffman, Katherine, Peil is here, and Neil Theise is here, and I've asked them to each say a bit about themselves as they introduce. Just to put this into a little bit of context and give you a bit of time frame, I've asked each of the panelists to speak for about 5 minutes each. Then we will have a discussion of about 20 minutes and hopefully leave 20 minutes open for just questions and general discussion. So I'd like to have this be a real discussion section. To give you a little bit of context on the topic of the evolutionary origins of the self, here's a slide. You've probably all seen trees of life, and very often trees of life sort of have humans at the top. Again, 18th century, 19th century thinking. This is a tree of life published a couple of years ago. It's scaled roughly to diversity. So distance in this tree roughly represents biological diversity. And you can see that almost everything up here are single-celled organisms. And in fact, everything except on the extreme right are bacteria and archaea, so not even cells like us. And the red arrow there points to animals. Actually, on the tree, it's labeled metazoa, which are organisms that have layers, like we have layers, inside and outside. And up there in the kind of blob above there, there's a little branch labeled plants. And you'll notice that critters like mushrooms are actually much more closely related to us than they are to plants. But the big story here is that life is extremely diverse. We and all the organisms that are familiar to us as macroscopic organisms are stuck in a little tiny corner of the diversity spectrum. And almost all of the biological diversity is in the single-celled world. And most of the diversity is in the non-eukaryotic, so the microbial, the true microbial world. Some old colleagues of mine, Bob Robbins and John Woolley, published a paper recently in which they pointed out something that's obvious once you hear it, but which, as far as I know, had never been pointed out before, that macroscopic organisms like us interact with the world mechanically. So I can pick up my glasses and move them around. I'm doing a mechanical operation here. But that in almost all of life, all but the handful of macroscopic organisms, the interaction with the world is not mechanical at all. It's chemical. And so the kind of sensations and the kinds of actions that you see in almost all of life bears essentially no resemblance whatsoever to the kinds of sensations and actions that we execute in our macroscopic bodies, which, as Neil pointed out a couple of days ago in his talk, are just enormous colonies of single cells. So with that as sort of an introduction and context setting by what do we mean by life and what do we mean potentially by the evolution of the self, I'd just like to introduce the questions that I sent to the panel a few days ago to guide this discussion. The first of them is, when did the self first appear? Are cells ubiquitous throughout life? Or is the self a relatively new kind of experience? What kind of self was it when it first appeared? So is the self of the creature called Luca in that last slide, which means last universal common ancestor. If Luca had a self, what was Luca's self like? And if you look carefully at that picture, you'll notice that in current thinking, Luca, our last common ancestor, was actually before DNA, even. So very, very old. And then the third question is the one that I think is the most important and that I hope that members of the panel will talk about, and then we can discuss, which is, if we think of life in terms of consciousness and selves and so on, with these concepts that we've grown up attributing to ourselves, how does that change the way we interact with life? How does it change the way we try to understand life? What new questions does it allow us to ask in the laboratory? What new experiments might it allow us to do? What new insights does it bring to us as biologists or just as people in general? So enough of that from me. I'm going to ask Neil to start this discussion, and then Katherine, and then Stuart, and then we'll have kind of a general talk. And I'll ask questions to the extent that you all don't. So, Neil.
Okay. This is okay sound-wise? Okay. What pays my bills is I'm an MD and a diagnostic pathologist specializing in the liver. So that means I spend a lot of my day looking at a microscope at a different level of scale from what all of us do the rest of the time, looking at liver biopsies from people, figuring out if they have cancer, not cancer, viral hepatitis, transplant rejection, things like that. And I think that to some extent that sort of daily experience of moving between scales has conditioned how I think about these things. That clinical work led me to explore liver stem cells. It was my group that showed that the liver has stem cells, and then from there we went into adult stem cell plasticity, and my group's paper sort of sparked Bush's address to the nation on stem cells, so unintended consequences, whoops. Lots of anti-abortion crowd. People wanted me to come talk to their groups after that because I obviously was opposed to embryonic stem cell research, and I said, do you really want this New York Jewish homosexual Buddhist coming to your group? And then they stopped calling me, so it was fine. That led me to an art collaboration with a woman named Jane Prophet, who introduced me to complexity theory and the work of Stu Kauffman, amongst others. And so people now call me a complexity theorist, although it's ridiculous. You know, I walk into this room and he's sitting there. No, I'm a complexity dabbler. And what that perspective basically led me to was that, just as Chris just said, so the body at this level of scale interacts mechanically. We are sort of like a machine. We're objects that are separate from each other. At the microscopic level, we're not things at all. The way you look at a flock of birds in the sky, it looks solid, it looks like an object, but you know it's birds. In the same way, you come look at a body at the microscopic level, the bird disappears, my finger disappears, it's just a community of cells, most of which aren't even human. 90 to 99% of them are not human, and without them, you wouldn't be alive as what you think of as yourself. And then when you go down, but you go further, and you go down to the nanoscopic level, is that me?
It's rubbing against your beard.
That was me, sorry.
Oh, it's rubbing against your beard. Non-local, it's rubbing against his beard. Okay, so. Swami Biyandananda got me started, I guess. So, quick. But you don't stop there. Are cells inherent things that exist independent, no matter how you look at them? No, because if you go down to the nanoscopic level, they are merely assemblies of biomolecules afloat in water. And so what about the molecules? Are they things? No, they're just atoms that are self-organized. And those are just subatomic particles that have self-organized. And those are just smaller subatomic particles self-organizing. And those are just either strings or something we don't know precisely what that are coming in and out of the vacuum, energy turning into matter and sinking back in again. So there is no thing in this hierarchy, or a better word, holarchy of the universe, that isn't part of a self-organizing system, and none of it has any inherent existence. There's no thing you can point to that is always a thing independent of perspective. Implication of that is I hold my finger up, and at this level of scale, I'm bounded by my skin. And if I think of myself at this level of scale, this is where I stop. But at the cellular level, I've left bacteria all over the place here. And all of us, if you live with anybody or with pets, you are a shared microbiome. And your microbiome has one, two, or three, depending on how many household members you have, islands on which they live. And they're really the main thing going on in your apartment or your home. It's not you. And when you shake hands with someone, then your boundary has extended. At the atomic level, there's no atom in your body that has not been drunk, eaten, or breathed from the planet. So you can think of what we typically think of ourselves as beings that live on the Earth. But it's just equivalently true that you are the Earth that has self-organized into beings that think of themselves as separate. But at the atomic level, your boundary is at least the entire planet. And when you go to the quantum realm, then you're talking about non-locality and you've got to the whole universe. Where this has led me, research philosophy-wise, I work with Menas Kefatos, who many of you have heard speak here this weekend. And what we're positing, at least as an equivalent idea compared to the idea that brain makes mind, is that fundamental awareness is what underlies everything. And that becoming aware of itself, the non-dual, slipping into duality, gives rise to space, time, matter, and energy in the whole universe. And we call that a fundamental awareness, and it's a framework to cross-talk between philosophy, science, metaphysics, etc. Okay. So then, how all that relates to these questions, to me, there are a couple of different ways to answer it in 1 minute. One is, this boundedness being scale and perspective dependent means the self is scale and perspective dependent. So to talk about a self is true only from certain perspectives. And at other perspectives, like a state of samadhi, where you're in continuity with the whole universe, it doesn't make any sense to say that. Or the self then becomes the unbounded, extending out to the universe. And neither one of those things is true to the exclusion of the other. And Manas and I talk about this as complementarity, like wave-particle duality is complementarity. No one understanding gives you the complete picture. The moment you conceptually latch on to one definition, you lose something. If you switch to capture that other something, you lose that. So the idea of the self in the first place, there is no such thing as a reified self, but that doesn't mean selves don't exist. They exist in certain perspectives and in certain circumstances, depending on where you put your attention. Simple thought experiment, and then I think I'll finish with that. So you think of yourself as a being born of your mother, but if you go and separate, one hopes, but if you go back in time to that moment of conception, there is no moment of discontinuity between the life of your body and the life of your mother's oocyte. Back into her body, all the way back to her mother, and through her mother. Back through all these layers of evolutionary development. We are one continuous living being on the planet going back to those earliest things, and there's no discontinuity anywhere in there. So when you think of yourself as this self, that is true. And we need to think of ourselves as this self because how else are we going to feed ourselves or run from the tiger? There's an evolutionary advantage at some point to thinking of yourself as distinct. But just as equally true is that we are all a part of one living organism that is deluded to think we're separate from each other. And so that's a good solid example, I think, of how this notion of self is perspective dependent. And we're always making a selection, and there is no right selection. There's only an appropriate selection for any particular given moment that's adaptive or not adaptive.
Thank you.
Okay.
Katherine, you want to pick up?
Yes.
Here are your slides.
I'm Katherine Peil, Kauffman, married to that guy. And I call myself an interdisciplinary emotion theorist. I've done research into emotion for a long time, both independently and finished up the science and religion program at Harvard Divinity School. So there are several ways to think about what is a self, when did it first appear, both of which come from my work, and I'll be talking tomorrow about emotion and the main message of my emotion work is this sort of missing piece understanding that emotion is a sensory system. And it serves the function of self-regulation. And that term spans lots of different dimensions. And in fact, Neil was talking yesterday about Niels Bohr asking about complementaries in physics, and there might be wondering about complementaries in biology. And I'm suggesting that the emotional sense is actually ground zero for several logical complementaries that we've sort of missed from our model. So the key idea is that the function is self-regulation, and that it is an ancient sense, the first to have emerged, and that the first perceptual qualia were something like what we experience as pleasure and pain. And this was coupled to approach and avoid behaviors so that there was not only the ability to move the body in toward that which is good for me and away from that which is bad for me, but it also provided this coupling of feelings and behaviors, provided the foundation for Pavlovian learning. So it actually ushered the first form of mind. So already we have like a mind self and a body self, and what I like about this, I call this work emotional vitalism, because the emotional sense through this biological lens is actually providing both the animating and the guiding functions that the vitalists thought belonged to force or spirit or soul. So that gives us another way of thinking about self at this deeper level of what that might be as well. So in answer to the first question about when did it emerge, I say that, whoops, I went too far. What did I do? Thank you, my savior. I say that it actually emerged with the origins of life, but that, one more, two more. Here I have the tree of life. This is perfect right here. This is the, if you ask about what the sensory system, what the sensory organ is, excuse me, this is way before brains or anything else. This is the signaling receptome, which in this model, the it's a chemical system that works at the sensory receptor within the cell membrane. So this is something that, this is very ancient. And if you look on this family tree, at the very bottom is the 7TM receptor, which is the one that we're talking about, that I mapped the sensory motor circuitry of the E. coli bacterium. And this is the common LUCA receptor that we all share. It responds to peptides, which ancient peptides, which Candace recognizes as the molecules of emotion. There's a whole emotional flow of neuropeptides downward and neurohormones that are part of our regulatory processes, including immune system and everything else. But what I think is really cool about this is that this 7TM receptor that every living system has is all about molecular clocks. So it's about the biorhythms, genetic products are made in the right amounts and go to the right places at the right time. So this idea of clocks speaks of maybe some deeper aspect of self that might involve a perception of time. And I can't go into all of it, but let's just look quickly at the arrow of evolution, and that you see not only do you see a mind-body kind of complementarity where it's moving the body and forging the mind, you also see a dual sense of identity where the self is sort of in the mind that's being developed has both an autonomous identity as an individual and a social identity as a communitarian kind of, and this is all within the individual, and that they're loosely mediated by positive and negative emotions. So even from the very beginning in the E. coli bacterium, through quorum sensing, using just slightly fancier peptides, you not only get me self-regulation, but you also get we self-regulation. So one of the things we've missed in this complementarity is that the individual self that we have has both the mind, not the body, has both a me and a we identity. You see it all the way up the evolutionary scale. You also see emotional behavior in the structures of the brain. So the deeper question here, so if this dual identity of mind might smack of something deeper, more a conceptual, more abstract kind of part to whole relationship, something like what Neil and Minas talk about, something very, very deep within are the self-organizing dynamics, the world, something fractal, where you can get parts and wholes with self-similarity at different levels. And so one of my dualisms that I introduced from this work is this idea that the Cartesian body and mind is actually all over right here in the classical realm, if you will, in the mind-body, but that there is something in the self-regulatory sense that's it's dependent on a constant comparison between the self and its not-self environment, and it shows up in the immune system and even epigenetic regulation higher up, but that this self-not-self comparison, even though it yields this beautiful chemical machine, it requires something deeper that I call fundamental, perhaps quantum consciousness, the capacity to observe. So I talk about the mind-body being here, but it's also undergirded by this bottom-up quantum consciousness without, and you need both for this whole process of life and any kind of sentience at all. So that's one of the dualities here, but that I like to suggest that there is not only this top-up self-organization that has this part-to-whole dynamic and this binaries, but that the complements from above, there's a dynamic actual interaction between the bottom-up self-organizing processes and the top-down self-regulated doing. So it's all part of this deeper self-organizing creative dynamic of the universe, and the implication is that not only do our mindful thoughts and emotions affect our body through the chemistry, but that they might actually go all the way down and tweak probabilities up and down. And that I love Minas and Neil's beautiful picture of the idea that sentience goes all the way down to what might be a unified awareness, which in my model would be the self with a capital S. So you have a small self, ego self, and the mind body, and then you have this bigger, beautiful thing that's constantly interacting with it. So then the self-not-self comparison that shows up all the way through here is actually maybe a self-not-yet-self comparison with something very deep in terms of quantum potentials or the universe becoming to know itself. But what I find really empowering about this new view is that it is a participatory process, and that the ultimately, what we experience as pleasure and pain dispels the notion of a good and evil dichotomy, because it's just not there when you see all the complementary logics that are there. So there's lots of hope, I think. So I think I've answered most of the three questions. It emerged with living systems, and if not multicellularity, the self has these beautiful dualities, but ultimately some unity. And I think that this idea of level independent self-organizing dynamics with parts and wholes, and how there's always this perspective where the inside out, self-relevant, self looking out at its external environment, you have like a series of Russian dolls where at each level there's an external environment and an internal environment. The external environment might be another self looking out on it, but there's this beautiful sort of bottom-up and top-down organization that gives rise to our feelings, frankly. So I think the self is like the coolest thing ever.
I'll just remind you here briefly about these and then turn it over to Stuart. Let me give you your first slide.
Thanks. 30 years ago in polite scientific society, you could not talk about consciousness. It was called by Philip Anderson, the Nobel laureate, the C word. Now we're talking about conscious nerds. It's a C word. Self is even harder than consciousness, and consciousness is very hard. So I want to suggest the following, and we're all having these experiential things in this conference. Awareness has what might be called a dual, that which is aware. There can't be awareness without that which is aware. I can find it in myself, and I'm not a meditator. Try it for a moment in yourself and see if you can find behind the specific awarenesses, like the visual field, there is in myself this sense of that which is aware. I don't know if you can find it, but I can. So let's try the idea that this dual, that which is aware, is the nub, the root of self. By the way, the great philosopher Hume tried to find the self rather like you do, Chris, in your great talk. And he says, all you have is a bundle of awarenesses. So let's try the idea that there's a dual of awareness, that which is aware. The evidence for this, I think, is introspection. And part of what I want to struggle with is, where do you have, what kind of evidence for something like a self? So I'm being both a scientist and a philosopher and whatever. If you say that awareness has a dual, that which is aware, then you're driven to say, point three, that wherever there is conscious awareness, there has to be its dual, a self. So I'm now going to propose, as I did in my talk a little while ago, that conscious awareness is associated with quantum measurement. So those of you, if you heard my talk, I can't explain quantum measurement in 5 minutes. It's a quantum process. Now, is there any third party, objective evidence, not experiential, for awareness having something to do with measurement? And it's Dean Radin's experiments that I talked about in my talk. In the two slit experiments, by altering the interference patterns by people 1,000 miles away. I don't believe Radin's results yet either. They're very weak. They're 1 in 100 million, he claims. If it's repeated about 100 times, we'll begin to believe it. But if so, Dean Radin has a consciousness meter. He has a way of telling whether or not something is conscious, or at least has intent. Now, suppose we believe Radin's results. I'm struggling for third-party evidence for self. Then we would say, if Hume is conscious, then we'd say we're conscious by, of course, we all know we're conscious, except some people who say it's an illusion, and I never know of what. If we accept that we're conscious by third-party evidence, like Radin's, then there is a dual. It's our self, okay? Now, if ourselves are real, then by analogy, we can think that monkeys have selves, and so do animals that can recognize themselves in a mirror. And behavior in general, just what we always use, that ethologists use all the time, to infer selves and behavior. Now let's ask, how far down does consciousness know? Well, of course we don't know, but how do I get to the next slide? Can you do it, Chris? So in my talk a little while ago, I suggested that quantum variables, photons, electrons exchanging photons, or quarks exchanging gluons, fermions exchanging bosons, are measuring one another. And there's two lines of evidence for this that I talked about in my talk. But briefly, there's a process called decoherence, where for an open quantum system, the environment that's quantum measures the quantum variables of the quantum system. Let's just stop with that. If that's true, then quantum variables really are measuring one another. But then we're led to say, if human consciousness is associated with measurement, then we can postulate that quantum variables measuring one another are conscious when co-measuring. I can't think of the faintest line of evidence for that at all, okay? But if they measure one another, and we think that measurement is associated with consciousness, then we have to say that, then we have quantum variables that have a dual of that consciousness, which is a self that's sitting there in quarks, okay? I don't believe this. I think it's a logically consistent argument. This is a panpsychism in the cosmos. Spinoza started this at the same time as Descartes in about 1670. He was not the first panpsychist, and I think Catherine and I are latter-day panpsychists. A lot of people are. This proto-consciousness is obviously, in some sense, very primitive. We have no idea what it is, of course, but then consciousness and selves go all the way down. They don't start with life. Life started with consciousness before it in the universe, and life has evolved with consciousness. So I end with the following, and it's exactly Catherine's slide, and it's Chris's great slide showing the evolution of life from Luca to trees and us. Well, Catherine was talking about E. coli and its self-regulatory system and its sense of smell. There's a single cell eukaryote. I can't remember the name of it, but it's quite astonishing. It's a eukaryote. It's evolved an eye, and it was found about 100 years ago, and it's been refound recently, and it's got this red eye. The lens is made out of mitochondria, and you see it kind of chugging along, looking quite earnest as it goes. Well, why does this have an eye? It has a focusing lens, and it really exists. It's hard not to think that that thing is maybe conscious. Of course, you can argue that it's a robot, and this is a sensory system like in a robot that's finding a light a power source. Why not try the idea that it's conscious? I am perfectly willing to believe that it may be conscious. Then it has a self by the dual of consciousness. Well, what about Stentor? This is an organism that, Katherine told me about. It's a single-celled organism, and by gosh, if you shock it with a chemical shock, it kind of shrugs its shoulders and curls up and says, go away. Of course, it doesn't say anything. It's a single-celled organism, and if you really annoy it, it attaches itself from where it's attached and uses its stomach to crawl along and go somewhere else. It looks like it's aware. Do I know that? Of course not. But the one with the eye really... Now, what about sharks? Well, sharks got to be conscious, and so are we. So, to summarize it, I think that there's a plausible thread that I don't believe that says that self goes all the way down, that quarks exchanging gluons have consciousness, and therefore they have the dual of consciousness self, and it's just part of the structure of the universe. And I don't think, if you know David Chalmers, the hard problem, I don't think we're going to get it any other way. I don't believe it, but I do. Thanks.
Thank you very much. With that, we can get rid of slides. And let me ask first if the panel has questions for each other or requests for elaboration.
Yeah. Stuart, mm-hmm. I wasn't quite sure in the first sentences when you started to speak, you talked about you were headed into consciousness and self being dual, but you had a qualifier in there about not having meditative practice.
You have.
Pathetic, but yes, practice. It's not my practice I would relate to, and I think this is one of the points that Minas and I are trying to pull off with our framework, is that everything you've described, I think, really encompasses both Western philosophical stuff, which you referenced, and contemporary scientific stuff, which is the body of what you practice. But the excluded middle, or the excluded off-site, is the multicultural, independent, first-person experiences of what you perceive when you look in, which you sort of referenced. And the consistency with it, the diversity of language to describe those experiences is quite beautiful and remarkable, but the consistency of how they fit together to give a picture of awareness that doesn't require a thing which is aware is sort of at the core of many of these experiences. And so I think that where we would differ from you and where we would probably, I still am confused about the meaning of panpsychism because some people accuse me of being one and other people tell me I'm nothing like one, is that are we going down to the quantum vacuum, quantum foam, and that's where that lowest level exists? And then the way you're describing it seems to me, certainly the way Stuart Hameroff describes it, is that whatever is proto-conscious is happening at that level. But if you include that those other metaphysical perspectives, then there's a level beneath that, and that is truly non-dual, out of which the rest is arising. And so we don't talk about, it still leaves open the question of what kind of consciousness does an electron have, if it has any.
But to say the least.
Right, yeah. Brum, brum. But that awareness, which doesn't require boundaries and which doesn't require consciousness as we describe it often in this room, just that pure awareness is sufficient to then give rise to everything else. So I don't know what the word, if that's not panpsychism, I'm not sure what it is, but we're calling it fundamental awareness. How do you respond to that approach to how you're approaching it?
So two things. I could certainly experience my visual field. I have no trouble with that. And I can see your slightly purple shirt. And I think it's slightly purple, brownish purple. and smells and hearing and so, and fear and all sorts of other things. I can, in some sense, be aware of that which is aware in me. It's kind of a quiet place that's aware. And I've tried to look at it and experience it. But it's not a place of, it's not a qualia in the normal philosophy sense of qualia. It's not orange. I'm not seeing orange. I'm simply finding a quiet place. It seems to be that which is aware. The only evidence I have for it is introspection. Do I trust it? Well, no. Do I think sort of it's right? Yeah, yes. Now, I know that there are meditators and so on that, that speak of getting to a place that's, well, that you're talking about. I never have experienced that, so I can't speak to it. You're then going way beyond where I know how to go at all. There are people who are doing things like, as everybody here knows, that, you know, it's loop quantum gravity and so on that people are struggling with before space and time, and they want to get space and time to emerge out of loop quantum gravity. It's one of the series approaches to quantum gravity. Do I think that's conceivable? Sure, there's a bunch of people working on it, and they've done all sorts of things. Is it then conceivable that there's some consciousness associated with it? Why not? We don't know where consciousness is. When I listen to you, Neil, all I can say is, oh. So it's not that I have an intelligent response, it's an interested response. I don't know if that helps.
Yeah, it does.
Can I bring up a question in which I'd like you to maybe reminisce a little bit or just comment philosophically on? Stuart mentioned the fact that not so long ago in academia, it was fairly verboten to talk about consciousness. I can certainly remember that time. But if you look at the literature now, and if you just listen to scientists talk, physicists talk all the time about particles feeling forces, for example. Biologists seem, to me at least, to be increasingly comfortable talking about cells perceiving things, cells making decisions, organisms at all levels of phylogeny communicating with each other, exchanging messages, and on and on and on. This language, I think, is now, if not ubiquitous, at least commonplace. So what I would like to ask the panel to comment on is, do you see in your professional colleagues in particular, or in the kind of scientific discourse in general, an increasing openness to this idea that we've been discussing here, that awareness is actually pervasive, and that this kind of talk about describing quorum sensing among bacteria, for example, as social communication, which, you know, to me, it seems obvious that it's social communication. Obviously, to you, it seems obvious that it's social communication. Is that idea really penetrating scientific discourse in a way that should make us, in a sense, all optimistic that some of these old prejudices are starting to fall away?
Well, I'm an optimist. I started out in clinical psychology, and I wanted to understand emotion, which I had already figured out was sort of the ground zero for some of the best and the worst of human behavior. And you couldn't talk about consciousness, really. I mean, there was everything was about finding empirical ways of testing this and testing that, because we had this tiny little tether to call ourselves a science to Darwinian evolution. And I found that just so limited that I started a nonprofit and started my own research, and that was 25 years ago. But over that time period, I've seen a lot of really positive change. And in fact, Stu and I both participated in a special issue on phenomenology by a, what was it? Mathematical biological biologist, something like that. really good.
Flamen Simeov was the
really editor. Good collection of discussions of phenomenology from all aspects of science. Also, there's this beautiful field called biosemiotics, which is all about the idea that cell signaling is communication. These are meaningful signals that are being exchanged. It's a language. And in quorum sensing, it's not just that they're having a party. They literally have cooperative behavior or competitive behavior. They can ball up together to mount a defense against antibiotics, or they can launch a virulent attack against another species. So you have us versus them tribalism. But there's also a trend in physics called endophysics, which I think is really cool, to bring the idea of subjectivity back into the discussion, where it's the idea that this subjective perspective looking outward might very well have something to do with how the universe operates. And those of us that have been thinking about this without limitations sort of really embrace that already. And there's also a lovely young man from Germany by the name of Andreas Weber, who wants to replace the Enlightenment paradigm of old with a new paradigm of enlivenment, where sentience, subjectivity, and life is really the center of our pursuits in science in the future. And so I think that's a really good trend. And there's hope. Yeah. But, you know, we have to wait until the minds that carry these beliefs die. That's what do they say, one death at a time? So I'm optimistic anyway, but it might not be in my lifetime.
Well, I'm glad you brought up the concept of endophysics, which is, I think, was introduced, 20 or 30 years ago out of cybernetics. And
cybernetics.
So there are other communities that are doing a lot of work in this area also, who I've at least never seen represented at this conference, but they're out there. Neil or Stuart, did you want to comment on this?
Well, I liked Catherine's summary. I thought there was a lot in that, and you've covered a lot of things. Say that it's emerging. I think you're right, that it's legitimate. And there's something really general here. We are conscious. Too bad. We really are. It's really part of the universe. Therefore, to understand how consciousness is part of the universe is a fundamental task that we haven't been willing to even think about. And, you know, where does it go? Well, what if it goes all the way down? People are beginning. There's people in this audience that Federico thinks, whom I just met, is writing a book about this. Is it now increasingly legitimate to struggle with it? Absolutely. And the thing to contrast it with, I don't know if you all know Jacob and Monod. They, in the 61, discovered that one gene can make a protein that turns another gene off. It's called repression. And then they published a little thing where two genes repress one another, which set me up for my life's work. And Monod wrote a book called Chance and Necessity. Mm-hmm. It's this absolutely brilliant book that came out maybe in 71. He's now gone, of course. He's an utterly brilliant scholar. He struggled with the issue of agency and doing, and he said, but it's as if doing. It's teleonomy, not teleology. It's an evolved machine that looks as if it's going to get food, but it's just a selected molecular machine. There's no agency, there's no doings, there's only happenings. And part of what I think that my struggle is Monod's brilliant. In Monod's era, you could not say conscious. Mm-hmm. Now, when we argue about all of this, it's good to go back and read Monod's book, Chance and Necessity, which Catherine and I reread about 5 months ago, and I lost in the airport in San Francisco. I was an agent, and I lost it. Monod is our touchstone to argue with. If he were here, he wants what we want. He didn't know how to get here, and he would be the critical person to debate with. Hmm. And he would be brilliant. So the answer is, Monod is still there. Okay? And he's still brilliant. So if we're going to do this, we take him on. So go read Chance and Necessity.
Good advice.
Deepak said something in one of his things this weekend about how medical schools are changing in response to integrative medicine type issues, and I get asked by students to come speak to them about that kind of stuff all the time. And in my generation and the prior generation, which was mine, we would never think to ask the question. We wouldn't have been allowed to invite anybody. But that's a generation. That's 25 years that's taken. And so I don't know if I'm a pessimistic optimist or an optimistic pessimist, but I think, yes, things are changing, and they're changing one funeral at a time. I think we very rarely convince anybody to change their minds, whether it's about being racist, misogynist, or any of the stuff, any side of the equation we're talking about now. But is there a movement in our society, in the academic world? Yeah, I'm not thrown out because of the stuff I'm doing. To some extent, I'm allowed to do what I do because I still do orthodox liver pathology, whatever that is. So as long as I'm doing that, I'm allowed to do this. But I think 25 years ago, if I were doing this, it would delegitimize that. Mm-hmm. And I don't experience that anywhere. And the fact is that 25 years ago, I would have had no place to go to meet people to have these conversations, I think. And today there are numbers of them.
I just want to say something that you're reminding me of. I wrote my fourth book, it's called Reinventing the Sacred.
Yeah.
And it's about the fact that there's no law that entails the becoming of the biosphere. So it's utterly creative out there, and that is sacred for me, or sacred enough. So I wrote this book. I like it. You can read it if you want. What happened is interesting because it's another forbidden topic. There's a very famous physicist in Italy, I won't say his name, and we were friends. And I was invited to a 60th party to celebrate, you know, the 60th thing. When they found out I'd written a book called Reinventing the Sacred, I was quietly disinvited. So, and I don't even mention God in Reinventing the Sacred. There's another threshold, okay? We all know that Galileo had the fight with the Inquisition. Galileo's our hero, right? Galileo said, "Eppure si muove," right? Nevertheless, the earth moves when he's led off to his house arrest. This isn't consciousness, it's something else, okay? It is, another frontier is, can we talk about something that is godlike? For example, if you're a panpsychist, whatever panpsychism really means, for me, I want to entertain the hypothesis that quantum variables exchanging, fermions exchanging bosons are measuring one another and are conscious. Suppose they are. Suppose they're entangled in the quantum mechanical sense, and they're all kind of collectively conscious, and they're disembodied. I actually wrote a paper called Cosmic Mind? I should have had three question marks. I don't think it's impossible. You're not too far from Indra's web, mm-hmm. Okay? You're not. And you're not either, Neil.
No.
And Manus isn't either. Well, okay, why not consider it? And why not bring it into the purview of what we worry about? And bless Mono.
That's, you know, Minas and I have been careful, and in part we're still dealing with very conservative perspectives, but we've been very careful in talking and writing about what we're talking about. That we're not saying this is the way things are. We are working with some degree of humility here. It's actually very much, Don, you're very careful about, you don't know if you're right, but it's a hypothesis that needs to be discussed. Mr. Conscious Agents over here, if you don't know. And for us, we're trying to put these concepts back on the map of reasonable discourse and saying you can't reject these out of hand. Our dominant cultural perspective is brain makes mind. But in fact, our dominant cultural beliefs say the opposite, because if you poll people on the street in New York City, which are, you know, is not Southern California, or not Middle California, everyone will have some idea of mind independent of brain. But we've got this weird kind of split. And so I think it's important to have all of these ideas on the table. Do I know I'm right? I have an instinct that we're onto something, but that's just an instinct. That's just a feeling, like you were describing before.
What do you mean, just a feeling?
Just a feeling.
Can I jump in here?
Please.
There's I mentioned that I started out interested in clinical psychology, and I think that there's another space of optimism here, because psychiatry and psychology really do not embrace anything close to the multidimensionality of experience that we have in terms of the human psyche, the relationship between the mind and the body and all of that. And I've been active in the positive psychology movement. Mostly one of the reasons I wanted to do this work to say you can't really talk about positive psychology until you know what positive and negative actually mean. But what I've seen over the course of the years is this really, really wonderful new thing about epigenetic regulatory processes that were not factored into the evolutionary model. And it turns out that some of the same chemistry that, some exact same chemistry that regulates the emotional sense has to do with switching genes on and off. And of course, we didn't know about that layer of regulation, and yet most of what makes us human is that upper layer of regulatory behavior that goes on in real time. So there's a connection, a clear connection already between the mind and the body and a top-down flow to the immune system. There's placebo and nocebo effects upon the body, and I think that this emotional chemistry that I'm talking about is probably one of the main conduits, because the commonality across physical illness and emotional disturbance is the stress response, and that emotion is actually our body's distress signals. On the other hand, positive emotions are too, and that whole dimension of excitation and pulling toward that which is more complexly pleasurable is a whole dimension of a developmental dimension we haven't even considered. So the inroad through epigenetics is kind of another physiological way that some of the psychological processes and problems, I mean, most of the disorders of the DSM-5, which is the canon for psychiatry, are characterized by emotional disturbances, dysregulations of too much pleasure, too much pain, and perceptions, entangled perceptions of time, space, and self, when you talk about schizophrenia and things like this. So there's all of these mysteries of human experience and what goes right, what goes wrong, that these more nuanced ways of thinking about the self, the mind, the body, maybe something deep like soul and psyche, that this, even if it's just the idea of quantum potentials or genetic potentials that are there to be actualized. I mean, even a cell goes through a developmental trajectory, finding out if it's going to be a liver or a brain cell or something, and there's stem cells, so there's something in this about identity at so many levels. We don't understand, so I think there's a lot of hope with the epigenetics and the mind-body stuff that's going on.
Well, thank you. I do want to have a little bit of time for questions from the audience. If someone has a mic that can take it around for questions. I can't actually see.
My name is Barbara. I'm glad to be here. Thank you. I've been sitting here. I've been wanting to say this to you guys. When you were speaking, and you brought in the mystical piece, I don't know how you quite expressed it, that the energy changed here. Mm. It was almost like it became a wave. I saw like a wave and a softening happening here. I don't know if anybody else witnessed it, but it was my experience. It's almost like it was particles first, you were talking, and then this softening happened when you introduced the mystical dimension. I don't know how you phrased it, but I think there's information there. I just want to say that.
Thank you.
That was the sacred feminine.
Right. And and I toss in, it might say more about the people in the room, because in other audiences, things get very hard at that point. But yeah, thank you.
I've been trying to catch the names. You're Neil, I forget your name, sir.
Me, I'm Stuart.
Stuart, that's right, thank you. Stuart, you said, you described a system of selfhood that you thought was plausible, but that you didn't believe. And I'm curious to hear if there's a system of selfhood that that you believe, or a system I'm curious, you described a plausible system that you don't believe. I'm curious to hear what you do believe.
Okay. I believe I'm a self. I think that Chris said it. We all run around thinking myself, my foot, my arm. And I try to talk about what I sense in my weak capacity to do introspection in a semi-meditative way, a quiet spot inside. What ways we talk? I've thought about consciousness now for 20 years, but I haven't thought about self. I think self is the dual of awareness. For me, it seems sort of obvious that you can't have awareness about that which is aware. But in a lot of contemplative traditions, I gather that what I just said is false. So I don't know what to say about it except for my own sense that I could find a quiet place where there's an awareness of being aware, but it has no other content. I don't know if other people do either.
I think we have a question somewhere in the back.
Yes, you testified that 30 years ago you couldn't use the word consciousness, the C word, as scientists. What I'm asking is now about another S word, which is soul. It seems to me hearing your discussion of self is very close to asking the question of soul, even as Aristotle talked about it, that it's intrinsic to all. Is it intrinsic to all beings? Or even the idea of anima mundi, the soul of the world and so forth. So, and it was interesting that Kathleen at the very end actually threw in the word soul as well. But how, put it this way, is self different from soul? Or has this whole discussion really been about what we used to call soul?
You want to take it, Chris?
Catherine?
Neil?
I have to admit that I never understood what people meant by the word soul, so I avoid using it. But I'm happy to talk about self in the kind of everyday sense that I talked about it in the talk. But I guess I am suspicious kind of across the board of ontological conclusions about these things, and maybe that's just a way of making Neil's point about complementarity, that all ontological positions are taken only from a point of view, and one's ontology can change radically when one takes a different point of view. I'm not sure that's right. Maybe it's right, but there is a language, at least, that I personally am not competent to use, I would say.
Do you use the S word?
I have this game. Deepak tends to interview me every 6 months for some nefarious purpose. And he, almost every time, he will ask me about God. And then I always say exactly the same thing. If you're talking to the nice Jewish boy, I'll talk about God, or in this case, soul. If you're talking about to the cell biologist, I'm not going to use those words. I'm going to talk about self-organizing systems. If you're going to, you know, for every, it's such a culturally specific laden term, there's some context in which I'm perfectly comfortable talking about it. I'm not using it in this room because I'm sort of pretending to have more of a scientific hat, but I was delighted when you brought it into the conversation. So I think that we have to always be mindful of what kind of conversation we're having, with whom we're having it, and what kind of language is thereby appropriate for that.
I'd just like to say quickly that all science aside, I don't think it should ever become unmoored from human experience. And there are really lovely experiences that we can have, paranormal experiences perhaps, but where I know I've had personal experiences where there is a sense of multi-level identity that is something so profoundly greater than the self, and yet there's almost like gestalts of identity. I had an experience concerning my unborn child 2 weeks before I was scheduled to have an abortion that changed my mind. but it was such a profound experience. It was just clearly these levels of intelligence and something so important that it changed my attitude completely from an ignorant, scared child to the most invested parent that I could be. So there's experiences like that that just, they resonate so deeply that the word soul, I think, is appropriate. And this idea of a self with a capital S, I love yours and Minas's model, with symmetry breaking that establishes boundary conditions that can be expanded or contracted by the individual, which is what I see happening with emotion. We have an empathic expansion to connect with one another, or we can contract that boundary back into a more autonomous identity, and we can really work hard to hate one another, but it hurts and it's self-destructive ultimately.
We're officially out of time.
Although that gentleman's had his hand up every time.
Why don't we just take one more question, then you can go ahead.
So you've talked quite a bit about acceptance in the wider scientific community of these ideas, and everybody's doing pretty well, it seems, at tracing from some kind of personal consciousness all the way down to vacuums and particles, some possibility, the acceptance of panpsychism, that consciousness is fundamental and so forth. But I'm interested in a science of spiritual development for the very reasons of your experience. And in the spiritual worldview, for example, Calk and Tononi have sort of grudgingly accepted panpsychism because there's nothing better, as Chris points out. But it's primordial, the same prejudice that you say about Damasio. It's sort of not interesting relative to this exciting multicolored stuff up here. And so there's sort of an inversion that exists even here at this conference of the way scientists are looking at this, even though trying to connect with the spiritual point of view, perhaps, in that the spiritual point of view puts that primal consciousness up in a sense. Ultimately, it's all non-hierarchical, but you're trying to get from the complexity of your life to that experience of the simplicity of a shared consciousness that Rupert talks about. And it's a non-trivial emotional thing. It can realign your entire being. It's not, does not get rid of the self at all, the physiological self. And in fact, there's still a lens. The self acts as a lens from the primal place. You can actually experience yourself as that place makes you completely in contact with other people, and everything is, this is practically like you can experience that you're in common with the root of the whole universal development system, kind of as you're suggesting. So I'm wondering if, and I believe Neil is closest to this in that you're making a mapping from Kashmir Shaivism to aspects of the evolution of the universe, and I wonder, I don't know, it's a comment. Are you people interested in looking at it in this other way eventually, or something like that, with the primal stuff being very important?
One of the things I have to be really careful about, I find when I talk about these things in Zen Buddhist groups or yoga collections, where people are specifically interested in the spiritual stuff, I am accused on that side of, why are you trying to explain or justify or verify our spiritual experiences through your scientific method? We don't need you. And I think that, again, for Minas and I, our aim is to find a way for all the people invested in this question, from whatever perspective they have, to be able to develop a commonality of language where all of them are respected and all of them can then enter into a conversation and listen to each other. And I think that's the key thing. And I think this is that complementarity thing. I think that view is as important, but not more so, than a more purely contemporary Western scientific point of view. And that is no more, no less important than that kind of view, and then the philosophical traditions as well. So trying to stay neutral in the face of other people's certainty from any perspective, I think, is the real hard work of developing a field of consciousness studies. Because while this meeting is particularly inclusive in a friendly, huggable sort of way, although notice the New Yorker does not have a huggable badge, other meetings.
I do.
You don't live in New York anymore. You left. Good for you. But there are other meetings where the same people are invited into the room, and yet the striving and contention and guardedness is so profound. They're not talking to each other. And finding this kind of environment that respects all these views, I think that's kind of our project in doing what we're doing.
Well, I think that's a great place for us to wrap up. Actually, thank you very much.
Sure.
For thank that you. Statement, and thank you, Stuart. Thank you, Katherine. And thank you all for being here and sticking with us.
Thank you.